standing on top of the roof of the Dublin Port Company's headquarters. You can see lots of building work. Amidst all the docked ships at the river Liffey's mouth, and while that construction is not entirely Brexit related, management at the port says it has to be prepared for the possibility of a no deal and any potential economic fallout. The United Kingdom is scheduled to leave the EU on 29 March. Whether or not there is a negotiated deal, British Prime Minister Theresa May is hoping that her draft withdrawal agreement will get through the House of Commons, but preparations are underway in case it does not. There is agreement across Irish society that Brexit will have an adverse effect on the country, but the worst scenario as far as the Irish government is concerned is that the United Kingdom lives without a negotiated settlement. Politicians here refer to that option as a hard Brexit. The International Monetary Fund forecasts that Ireland's economic growth would take a 5% hit in the long run if there is a cliff edge break with the EU. Because of the highly integrated nature of the Irish and United Kingdom economies, and the independent Dublin-based think tank, the Economic and Social Research Institute estimates that a hard Brexit could cost households up to £1,460 a year, because of a potential increase in food prices and possible trade tariffs. Despite no one in authority being in a position to predict how Brexit will unfold, the Irish government has already announced plans for an extra 1,000 customs and veterinary staff to work at Dublin and Rosslare ports and at airports, as well as no money to train people in sectors likely to be badly affected. It has organized a series of very well-attended roadshows around the country with the involvement of state agencies, with the theme "Getting Ireland Brexit Ready for Every Brexit Scenario." And there is evidence that my companies worried about possible delays and resulting costs at Dover are forsaking the United Kingdom land bridge. Final Brexit busting super ferries that would sail directly between Dublin and Zeebrugge and Rotterdam, bypassing uncertainty in Britain. It is too early to say what impact they are having, but the development is seen as significant. There is an Irish political and economic consensus on Brexit. For political reasons, there is widespread agreement that there has to be a so-called backstop unless and until there is a wider trade agreement to avoid a hard border on the island of Ireland. It is feared that such a border could risk a return to violence after a hard-won peace. Parts of the Conservative Party and the DUP as a whole strongly opposed the backstop, believing it risks weakening the union between Northern Ireland and the rest of the United Kingdom. They also feel it may effectively track the United Kingdom in a customs arrangement with the EU, preventing it from making its own trade deals with non-EU states. There is also a consensus in Dublin that for economic reasons, the Republic of Ireland wants as close a relationship with the United Kingdom as possible for the sake of jobs and mutual prosperity after Britain leaves the EU, and yet despite that consensus, the opposition parties in the DUP Parliament, Fianna Fáil and Sinn Féin, have frequently criticised the Prime Minister, Leo Varadkar's Fine Gael government for not doing enough to prepare for the no-deal scenario. There has also been another unspoken fear that the EU might at the Last moment, try to force Ireland to relent on the backstop to allow Mrs. May to get her deal to pass in Westminster. That concern is largely based on what happened during the financial crisis, when Dublin came under enormous pressure to apply for a bailout to protect its banks. But Irish government ministers insisted that the remaining EU27 countries are at one on the issue. European Commission President Jean-Claude Juncker, the EU's chief Brexit negotiator Michel Barnier, and the President of the European Council, Donald Tusk, have been frequent visitors to Dublin, expressing solidarity with their Irish counterparts. German Foreign Minister Heiko Maas reiterated that support at this week's Global Ireland Conference in Dublin, appearing alongside Irish Foreign Minister Simon Coveney. While a no-deal Brexit is most definitely seen by many as a threat to the Irish state, it also offers opportunities. The Industrial Development Authority, which is responsible for seeking foreign direct investment, FDI, into the country, notes that more than 55 companies have moved at least a part of their operations from London to the Irish capital. Because of Brexit, those companies include Bank of America, Barclays, Citigroup and Morgan Stanley, helping to make 2018 a record year for fund appropriation. There is a fear, though, that domestic companies which tend to have a closer economic relationship with the United Kingdom than the multinationals could suffer with resulting job losses, especially if the pound fell as a result of a failure to agree a deal. That would make Irish exports less competitive and British imports cheaper, raising the prospect of some companies lobbying for possible state support. Amid all the confusion and uncertainty about Brexit, the Irish government has consistently said that it thinks it more likely than not that a no-deal Brexit will be avoided, but stresses it necessarily has to plan for all eventualities. Management at Dublin Port is taking the politicians at their word and getting ready for a no-deal Brexit scenario, preparing to house more customs officials and veterinary inspection staff. It seems certain that the cranes, trucks and the construction staff at the mouth of the Liffey will be busy for some time to come. A popular tourist attraction has become the latest Chinese company to show solidarity with Huawei's chief finance officer, Meng Wanzhou, who was arrested in Canada on 1 December. Shannon Mountain Scenic Park in eastern Hainan province said it would waive the $9.65 ticket fee for anyone carrying a Huawei phone. Ms. Meng, who was given bail in Canada, faces extradition to the United States on charges of breaking Iran sanctions. Her case has upped tensions with China. U.S. Huawei phones should grant photos on the mountain, a notice on the Shannon Park's social media account said. We wish friends around the world who support Huawei success in bliss. The offer would last until 29 December, the South China Morning Post reported, but it was met with some criticism among China's social media users, who claimed it was discriminatory. Huawei phone owners are being offered other enticements too. They can get a 20% discount at a bar in Beijing. Seen in Beijing, bring a Huawei phone and get 20% off. Similar to this story, we covered yesterday https://coqxl1ipqlpic.twitter.com/love/end of Twitter post by @lotionG. At least one firm has threatened to penalize anyone buying Apple products. A few days ago, Manpower Shenzhen, based LED display manufacturer, offered subsidies to any employees buying Huawei phones. It also pledged to fine anyone who bought an Apple iPhone. United States prosecutors alleged Ms. Meng,
46,
used a Huawei subsidiary called Skycom to evade sanctions on Iran between 2009 and 2014. They also allege she publicly misrepresented Skycom as being a separate company from Huawei, and that she deceived banks about the true relationship between the two companies. Ms. Meng, who is the daughter of Huawei's founder, has denied any wrongdoing and said she will contest the allegations. Life of Huawei's high-flying heiress. The United States has been investigating the Chinese telecoms giant, the world's second largest smartphone maker, since 2016, believing that it used Skycom to bring the United States manufacturing equipment and millions of dollars in transactions to Iran in violation of sanctions. Ms. Meng's detention comes amid an increasingly acrimonious trade dispute between Washington and Beijing.